Jai Hind and good evening everybody. I feel very humbled when I am introduced like this. I am a normal run-of-the-mill army officer who was lucky to get some opportunities, and I tried to maximize them. And what I find interesting is that tomorrow India is restarting after 1 year's gap the Times Literary Festival in New Delhi. Last year it was suspended. And day after tomorrow, in that literary festival, which is a signature event, the main theme of discussion is what? Yes, anybody who can tell me this. You know, nowadays people don't read newspapers. Only newspaper they read is WhatsApp time. But if you are reading newspapers, then you would know. Anybody who has known or who knows what is the main theme of that festival? Well, I will give you the main theme. That is nationalism in 21st century India, unifying or divisive force. And I compliment the organizers of this conference. They have chosen a complementary theme. What bothers entire India, we are also going to discuss at this level. And we are going to discuss it in an international context. So have a close look at the theme, closer together or further apart. Nationalism in a flattening world. So we'll discuss some concepts where I'll try and tell you about what is a nation, what is a state, what is nationalism, what is patriotism, and what is the Westphalian model which has brought stability to the world. Then we look at the second aspect, which is globalization. Is the world really flat? What are those flatteners? And we look at associated things connected with this. But now there is a resurgence in nationalism. We look at that also. And finally, before we conclude, we'll try and discover a way forward. What is the way forward? What does the young generation take from here? What is the key takeaway? So let us look at the concepts. What is nation? Nation is a large body of people united by a common culture, which is basically worked on a descent, history, language, and they live in a particular space, a territory. So you can call it a nation state, you can call it a nation, and that leads to a phenomena called as nationalism. Now nationalism is a phenomena in which in that space there is a common yearning to do self-rule, to protect your sovereignty, to run your affairs as you feel, to discover your own interests, which become the national interests, and to jealously safeguard them. Don't allow any encroachments on this. Now, this to you may appear a little naive, but it is a real problem. I was in Angola, and I used to share a residence with a couple of peacekeepers. Now, two peacekeepers came from Czechoslovakia, who used to stay with me. One fine day we learned that state of or a country of Czechoslovakia has got divided into two countries, Czech Republic and Slovak Republic. And would you believe it? I discovered that they come from two different countries now. And in our where we lived and where we had our kitchen, we used to have a frigidaire. Now in that frigidaire we had shelves, because we have issues like beef, we have issues like pork, because there was a Moroccan also. So we had divided those shelves. Now I was the team leader. Now this officer from Czech Republic and Slovak Republic, they said anything, but we will not share the shelf. We are two separate countries. If you can have a shelf, why will I not have a shelf? So then I negotiated with the Czech officer. I said, okay, because I had limited shelves. I said, I'll share the shelf with you. That is the urge of nationality. That you were together till one day back. And next day you say, no, we are two separate nations. We can't even share our shelf. And then you discover your enmities, animosities, and under a United Nations flag. So that is the challenge of nationalism. Now, like I told you, it leads to a political system, a socio-economic system, which gets confined to a space and develops your national interests. Now, what is patriotism? Patriotism is a feeling or a desire, an attachment, which is attached with a country, a love for that country. Now, these two thoughts may appear complementary to you. You may feel they are one and the same. Somebody could even use it in a synonym kind of a situation. But is that really so? Look at these two terms now. Look at patriotism and nationalism. If you go to the origins of word patriotism, it comes from a Greek root, which is basically patrios, which means related to fatherhood. And then this term got to France, and French started using it in a different form, patriot, and then ism got attached to it. But today, patriotism really means bravery, valor, duty, devotion. It's not such a dirty word. It has acquired a benign connotation in usage. And what has happened to nationalism? Nationalism incidentally came up about 150 years later. Patriotism came up, like it is given here, 17th century. And nationalism came up in 19th century, 150 years later. But today, nationalism seems to have acquired a malignant character. And today, it has acquired negative connotations. There is competitive nationalism, there is populism, there is associated fundamentalism which has got attached to it. After all, this is an international forum. After all, Pakistan was created for liberal Muslims. But it chose to name its capital Islamabad. It is the only country where the capital is named on a religion. And thereafter, what happened? The first president of Pakistan was a Shia, who was a liberal in terms that he was married to a Parsi girl. His daughter followed Parsi religion. His daughter got married to a Parsi also. And it is documented he ate pork, he drank whiskey. But over the years, under the pressure of nationalism, it seems to have gone the fundamental way. So this is a thought one has to consider. Now let me ask you all a question. Is India a nation state or a nation state? Anybody? Yeah. She says India is a nation. How many feel India is a nation? Let's raise our hands. Show of hands. Okay. Okay, put down your hands. How many feel? Okay. How many have come from South? Do you all feel comfortable in this Hindi-speaking city of New Delhi? Yes or no? No, you have learned the art of telling lies and diplomacy. India is divided by Vindhyas. So, a North Indian doesn't feel comfortable in Chennai. If he tries to speak Hindi, the other person doesn't even acknowledge him. He will see Hindi movies, but he'll not acknowledge him. So is India a nation or a state? How many feel India is a state? Raise your hands. Okay. How many feel India is a nation state? See, democracy wins. India is a nation state. Now let me explain this to you. See, nations are those where the culture is very common. You know, England, France, Germany, they are centered around one language. In India, language changes after every 20 kilometers. There are dialects. There are different cultures. Even the worship is of a different kind. So India is loosely defined as a nation state. That is how it is. Now, in this entire context of understanding these concepts, it is very important for us to understand the Peace of Westphalia. Westphalia are the twin cities in Germany. It is a region. Germany and Europe was facing a constant and long-standing war, which was going on for 80 years. If you read over here, from 1568 to 1648, a war going on for 80 years, which was being fought between Spain and Dutch Republic. Concurrently, towards the last part of this war, another war started between the Protestants and Catholics, which is called 30 Years' War. Now, sometimes in 1648, they signed a Treaty of Westphalia. And this treaty discovered the concepts of sovereignty, nations, nation states, the need not to interfere in each other's affairs, and brought some stability to the world order. And today also, it is the gold standard in international relations, that you normally do not interfere in each other's internal affairs. If you, in India, we talk of Panchsheel, which is basically a derivative or refined version of Westphalian model. So this is established those principles of sovereign state, international law, stability in world order. And it's important. You all do model UN conferences. I would recommend to you all study about Treaty of Westphalia. Read about it. This is the gold standard which keeps stability in the world. This is the firm base on which the international order is supposed to operate. Because of Westphalia and such treaties, there was a concept of boundaries. You know, earlier, the countries used to have buffer states. Tibet was a buffer between India and China. Afghanistan was a buffer between British Empire and Russian Empire. There were no man's lands. Those areas were called frontiers. There were no real laws in those areas. No real governance ran in those areas. Today also Pakistan has got a frontier region, which is called FATA. Federally administered tribal areas. Bajor, Malakand, Waziristan, they are all part of FATA. Now, somewhere with these treaties and stability coming to world, it was decided to go for concept of borders, where populations are settled, don't disturb them, don't change the borders. But border is a loosely defined term. If a border is sanctified properly, then it becomes a boundary. And you all would have heard of that famous old saying, good fences make good neighbors. If you have good fences, well-defined fences, there will be lesser problems. So that's why the concept of boundaries, international boundary between India and Pakistan, between various countries. Now, how are boundaries established? That's a separate topic by itself. I'll not be able to cover it, but just to give you a feel or an idea, The first concept is delimitation. You decide a basic broad principle, which could be watershed, the highest point along a ridge. It could be a line which is put on the map thereafter. So first concept is delimitation, a principle which is defined. The second concept is delineation. You draw a line on the map. Like between India and Pakistan, there is Red Cliff line. Between India and China, there is McMahon line. Between Pakistan and Afghanistan, there is Durand line. There are lines which are laid down. And then you demarcate them on the ground. That is the concept of borders and boundaries. And that keeps stability. If they are well defined, there are lesser problems. But now let's look at the contrary trend, which is globalization. And if you read the saying which is written here by Kofi Annan, who was the UN Secretary General, he says, arguing against globalization is like arguing against the laws of gravity. Globalization is as much of a reality as gravity is. Are we all bound by gravity? Yes or no? Yes or no? If we were not, then like spacecraft, we would have been touching the ceiling. But we are seated on our chairs. So gravity and globalization, he feels, is something like that. And this concept is started off with United Nations, a conference that you are attending like this. And then there were bodies like World Bank, International Monetary Federation, which came up. It is, the original monogram is flashed in front of you. 1st to 22nd July 1944. 7th December 1945. Detailed parleys, and this was sanctified. And this became the guiding or unifying force for international trade and commerce. Thereafter, Thomas Friedman wrote a very interesting book, which is World is Flat. You know, Christopher Columbus went to discover India, and he reached USA, America, and he came back and told his king that world is round. But Thomas Friedman, a leading columnist for New York Times, he came to Bangalore, had an interaction with Nandan Nilekani in Infosys campus, and thereafter he went and wrote an interesting, Nandan Nilekani used a term, he said world has got flattened out. Flattened out, what does it mean? We'll see it in the next slide. Basically it means that there is level playing field. You can do international trade, commerce, technology, and connectivity, internet, your mobiles, your laptops, all push you towards this. That world is flat. You are living not in silos. You are living in an interconnected world, which is connected with each other. Nandan Nilekani inspired Thomas Friedman to write World is Flat. But there is another professor in USA called as Pankaj Ghemawat. He holds a contrary view and he's written another book which says world is really not flat. It is semi-globalized. It is multi-domestic. It is not as flat as we think. There are blocks which are because of nationalism. And he says that is because of a cage. Cage is your culture, your administration, geography, and economics. They limit you. They don't allow you to become totally flat. Interesting concept, those of you interested. But if you have, even if you have less time, please go to Dr. Google and see this world is flat. The interesting video, it will open new vistas in your mind. We are looking at nationalism and resurgence. Now, see, globalization led to UN, World Bank, International Monetary Federation, World Postal Union, World Health Organization, and all such bodies. UN peacekeeping also came out of it. And I must tell you another interesting story, because the thing about taking a lecture is that after every 10 minutes you must tell a story, otherwise you lose the audience. See, the first Pakistani I met was in Angola during my peacekeeping. He's a wonderful human being. We both shared the room. We became very personal friends. He cooked for me often. One day, we got invited for a dinner. It happened to be 14th August. So at midnight hour, in Angola, parties run late. They start late, they run late, they finish late. So at midnight hour, somebody brought out two cakes. One cake of Indian flag, national tricolor, second of Pakistan, crescent and star. One in green, one in three colors of India. Wonderful cake, two of them, cakes brought out. Now, the hostess told us that please come and cut the cake, your independence. And everybody said, I was a major then, Major KJ, you cut the Pakistani one, and Mumtaz Tazi, his name was Mumtaz Tazi, you cut the Indian one. So I was walking towards Pakistani cake. He came and held my hand. He said, in Punjabi, he said, because he spoke wonderful Punjabi. Incidentally, he came from my mother's village before partition. See how we are connected in this world. So he held my hand and he said, Major, you cut yours, I'll cut mine. See that fear, insecurity. You don't even want your cake to be cut by somebody like this. That's why this, all this brawls or this thing which is taking place on national anthem, people getting beaten up, it's because of this. Or jingoism or over-attachment with symbols. But let me get back to the theme. There were also regional bodies like Organization of African Union, there is European Union, Organization of American States, all these bodies came up. Concept of collective security came up. So you had NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, CATO, CENTO, Warsaw Pact as a reaction. You also had economic cooperation, NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement came. Now Trump is trying to rescind it. European Economic Community, European Common Market, all these things came up. ASEAN. So this was the trend of globalization. But has it finished nationalism? Has it suppressed nationalism? No, my friends, no. Because when UN came into being, it had 50 countries who signed. Poland had not signed on the initially and signed later. So there were, say, 51 countries. And how many countries are member of UN today? How many? Some say 193, some say 194. But from 51, we have become 193. So nationalism is growing, is not getting curtailed. Also, there was end of colonialism. Lot of nations came up. And what was interesting is on 26 December 1991, Soviet Union collapsed. So from one country, 15 countries came out. Here it is on the map. See, one Soviet Union became 15 countries. And some countries are fighting with each other. Ukraine is fighting, Georgia is fighting. There are problems with Russia. There is a resurgence of nationalism. You can't wish it away. Why did it take place? Because of migration of jobs, because world is flat, globalization took place. Jobs went away to China, other countries, and suddenly Americans discovered that they have huge, big unemployment. What do we do? influx of refugees. Today you see the football team of France. About 80% players are of African origin. So refugees came in, but unfortunately with all good, bad also happens. So somewhere ISIS, terrorism, cultural clash started taking place. And you have things like Beslan massacre in Belgium. You had these incidents in France. Terrorism has come to Europe, right into their homes. So they have woken up. What to do? Then there was Brexit. Suddenly the Britain decided to exit from European Economic Community and European Union. Then election of Trump, populism politics. You have no other issue to become popular, take identity as an issue. Now there is another phenomena which is taking place, which is called Thucydides' trap, which is based on what happened in Sparta. In earlier times, Sparta and Rome, that when in a stable order, if a country is rising, there is bound to be a clash. So aggressive and assertive China is actually bull in the China shop. There's a problem. Whole world has to adjust to that. So it leads to nationalism. This is a challenge for globalization. And issues of hegemony. Is world unipolar? After World War II, it became supposedly unipolar with America ruling the roost. Then it became bipolar. America and Warsaw Pact, Russia competitive power. Then again, Russia collapsed. It became unipolar. Now it is tending to become bipolar again with China rising. Will it ever become multipolar? India tried non-alignment and all this, but does it work? National interests? These are the challenges. You have to look at these. What is the way forward? This is my last slide. So, it is firstly co-engage. The concept has to be co-engage. Children, please give some attention to this slide. It is the key takeaway for you. For future, you are going to be global citizens. You have to help this world. It needs your wisdom. And that can come around these little projections I am trying to make to you. First thing is cooperate to extent possible. India and China also cooperate in climate talks, in so many issues. We must cooperate wherever we can. We should also cooperate with Pakistan. Wherever there is a convergence of opinion, fighting narcotics, terrorism, we must cooperate. Then there is compete. You have to compete. Market is one. So you have to compete. India and China are competing for oil blocks in Sudan. India and China are also competing for oil blocks in Vietnam. Competition is inevitable. You have to sometimes compete. Compete in a healthy way. Thereafter, collaborate. Where possible, collaborate. For win-win, if you have 3 and 3, if you just add them up, it will become 6. But if you multiply them, it will become 9. Where the sum is greater than, or end result is greater than, just the sum of parts, that is synergy. But suppose you found a way to make it 33, then that is the real synergy. World needs that. That would be globalization in a correct way. We also need to look at conflict. We have to avoid it to extent possible. It should be the last resort only when the core national interests are threatened and when other means have failed. And in all cases, you must confabulate. You must talk. You must negotiate. You must learn to compromise. Find them acceptable compromises. You have to find the right balance between your national interests. I am not saying surrender your national interests, but the world needs people to stand up for common good. There are issues like global warming. There are issues like climate change. There are issues like pandemics. There are issues like poverty, health, which needs common solution, which needs technology to be leveraged. I hope this generation of young students will take it as a challenge and work towards it. With this, I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you. Thank you.